Enterprise, attention. Ladies and gentlemen, please rise for the arrival of the official party. Remain standing for the parading of colors, the national anthem, and the invocation. Thank you. Enterprise, arriving. Naval Air Force Atlantic, arriving. Program Executive Office, Aircraft Carriers, arriving. Naval reactors arriving. The colors. Ladies and gentlemen, our national anthem.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
Color Guard, retire the colors. Lieutenant Commander Hatton, Chaplain, USS George Washington, CVN 73, and Enterprise's last chaplain, will now offer the invocation.
Please join me in prayer. Almighty God, we ask your presence here as we pause to honor this brotherhood and sisterhood of the sea, one of your great creations. We are here to remember the service of one of the greatest carriers of the U.S. fleet. She was the first nuclear-powered carrier and the longest U.S. Navy warship ever built, living up to her name, the Big E. She has deployed in support of Iraq, Afghanistan, Vietnam, the Cuban Missile Crisis, and I'm sure countless others, places we can't discuss, keeping our oceans and borders safe. We ask your presence here, honoring all who have served on this ship, especially those who have given the ultimate sacrifice. Help us to remember with pride our time aboard. We ask these things in your name. Amen.
Amen. Ladies and gentlemen, you may be seated. Heads of department, report.
Reactor, all present or accounted for.
Very well.
Operations, all present or accounted for.
Very well. Very well.
Command services, all present or accounted for.
Very well. Enterprise, parade, rest. Side boys, post. Military guests may uncover. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to introduce the final commanding officer of USS Enterprise, Captain Todd A. Belts. Captain Belts is a 1989 graduate of the Pennsylvania State University with a Bachelor of Science degree in Electrical Engineering. He served in several sea and shore commands, most notably as commanding officer in USS LROD FFG 55, and as the executive officer and now commanding officer of USS Enterprise. Ladies and gentlemen, Captain Todd A. Belts.
Good morning. Welcome to the decommissioning ceremony of USS Enterprise. We have many distinguished guests here today, but I'd like to acknowledge a few. Admiral Caldwell, Naval Reactors. Rear Admiral Lindsay, Commander, Naval Air Forces Atlantic. Rear Admiral Antonio, Program Executive Officer, Aircraft Carriers. And Mr. Matt Mulheron, President of Newport News Shipbuilding. And we're fortunate to have a few of the former commanding officers, Vice Admiral Marty Chanik, the 16th commanding officer, Rear Admiral Dean Mewborn, 22nd Commanding Officer, Captain William Hamilton, 23rd Commanding Officer. And representing our 2nd Commanding Officer, Vice Admiral Michaelis, is his son, Commander Michael Michaelis. It's tradition the Navy ships have a sponsor, and as we know, Mrs. William B. Frankie is the Enterprise's ship sponsor, and with us today is Mr. Russell Fowler, who's graciously representing his grandmother. Thank you for being here. And to the rest of the Enterprise family here today, the sailors, the shipbuilders, friends, family, and guests, it's truly an honor to have you here today. As we decommission Enterprise, my first thought is that this small ceremony is for us, the family of Enterprise. And it's appropriate we are conducting this ceremony in this location, the dry dock where the ship was built. Tomorrow is the 59th anniversary of this ship's keel being laid in this very dry dock. So the place that we are gathered here today is truly a special place. Just over 4 years ago, an inactivation ceremony was held, a much larger ceremony and conducted prior to the major work that has occurred over the last 4 years. And at that time, we recognized the transition from operational service to non-operational status. And today, we recognize the time when we will strike this ship from the Naval Registry. And during that ceremony 4 years ago, there were many words on what a nuclear aircraft carrier does in support of our nation. The symbolism of such an enormous ship and the power it represents. Words were used like combat flexibility, naval presence. There were thoughts discussed about providing our nation's leaders with strategic options, as well as discussion on the enormous strike capability that an aircraft carrier and its air wing provide. And yes, this carrier led the way. It surpassed its mission in providing all those operational capabilities. But for all that Enterprise represents to this nation, it's the people that bring this ship to life. So as I stand here in a ship we all care so much about, I feel it's appropriate to underscore the contributions of the thousands of sailors and individuals that have kept this ship alive and made its reputation. So think of those who worked the flight deck, the red shirts, the yellow shirts, the white shirts, and others, that during day and night ops, planes could be launched and recovered from her flight deck, as well as those brave aviators who flew from this flight deck. To the engineers who toiled in the heat of the engine rooms, safely operating and maintaining the most complex yet most flexible engineering plant ever built. To the sailors operating the combat systems, the communications gear, working in the galleys, and the many numerous activities that kept this ship running. As well to remember the commanding officers, the officers and the chiefs that provided the leadership and the can-do attitude that was the driving force to ensure that this ship worked at its peak efficiency. And to always remember those who left the shores on this ship and never returned. We remember their sacrifice and their faith in our country. So remember the sailors of this ship that made Enterprise the Big E and have earned the motto, "We Are Legend." At the end of your programs, there's a letter from Admiral Holloway, who was the 3rd commanding officer of Enterprise. I wanted to highlight two things that he mentioned in the letter. First, I, along with the sailors that are here today, are also proud to count ourselves among the thousands of crew members who have called this ship home. He also recognized this crew and the crew members who have worked hard and the crew members before us who have worked hard and served this ship well. But I'm going to extend that definition of crew members today. Today's ceremony is smaller than it was 4 years ago by necessity, but us here today are the ship's family. the sailors, the shipbuilders, the engineers of naval reactors. And as I acknowledge the sailors, I need to recognize the other members of our family. The long history of this ship was well supported by the shipbuilders. They built Enterprise well, and they helped the sailors maintain this ship for its life of over 50 years. And with the guidance of naval reactors that allowed this ship to demonstrate the safe operation of nuclear power in this magnificent ship. It was this entire family that helped bring this ship to life. And we here today are representing those thousands before us that have brought this ship to life. So for all of us here and for all of us who could not be here, Enterprise is the big E. And we, all of us, have made her more than a ship. She is a part of us, and we are a part of her. The second part of Admiral Holloway's letter that I highlighted is his recognition of the time when CVN 80 will come into service, when she will become the ninth Enterprise. As this ship retires, we know the memories will live beyond her. And we, the sailors, the shipbuilders, the supporters of Enterprise, we are that link to the next Enterprise. And so I wish you all health and good fortune that we can be together when the next Enterprise is commissioned. And so for all of us who have served on her, supported her, and for the families that have supported all of us, I say well done, Enterprise, well done. And now, ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to welcome the president of Newport News Shipbuilding, Mr. Matt Mulherin. In his role at the shipyard, he is responsible for Newport News Shipbuilding engineering, operations, and programs to include nuclear-powered aircraft carriers and submarines. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Matt Mulherin.
Well, thank you. Good morning, everyone. Distinguished platform guests, ladies and gentlemen, I am honored to share in this historic celebration on behalf of the women and men of Newport News Shipbuilding, both our current shipbuilders and retirees. We are so proud of all that USS Enterprise has accomplished during her long and distinguished service to our nation. And we are honored to be here today to pay tribute to the ship that not only revolutionized our Navy, but transformed Newport News Shipbuilding into the nuclear shipbuilder we are today. We know USS Enterprise technically belongs to the Navy, but we still like to think of her as our ship. She's a special ship, and she creates a lasting impression that stays with you for a lifetime. For example, whenever we post anything about Enterprise on social media, it gets record hits. We've had shipbuilders plan their retirements around this ship, and we've received calls from shipbuilders who had to be here today to pay their respect to our nation's first and still fastest nuclear-powered aircraft carrier. As I look into the audience, I see so many faces that have been associated with this great ship. And I know you feel it too, the undeniable magic of Enterprise. If you're like me, today is bittersweet. It's the end of an era. However, there's a quote. Actually, it's from a fairy tale that we should all remember. The good and the beautiful is not forgotten. It lives in legend and in song. Now, I'm not going to sing, so you're okay. But I think quoting a fairy tale is quite appropriate, since they are magical, idealized, and grand. Just like this ship has been throughout her half century of service. Indeed, the USS Enterprise will always live in legend. But I'm very proud to share that part of her will continue to serve our nation for the next century. You see, we've taken some of her steel, and we will use it in the keel of our nation's newest Enterprise, CVN 80. Just like this ship, CVN 80 will hold a special place in the hearts of her shipbuilders. She will also be a first for us. She will be our first aircraft carrier built with digital work packages rather than traditional paper drawings. She will revolutionize carrier construction for us, just like CVN 65 did. And like CVN 65, our shipbuilders will pour their hearts and souls into every stage of her construction. With each piece of steel, with every pipe, with every weld, and with every cable. Because we know we aren't just building a ship, we are continuing the magic, the majesty, and the legend that is and always will be Enterprise. Thank you. And now I'd like to introduce our next speaker, Rear Admiral Brian Antonio, who serves as the Program Executive Officer for Aircraft Carriers. He's responsible for the design, construction, delivery, and lifecycle support of all United States Navy aircraft carriers. That's a pretty big job. Before he speaks, I'd like to ask him to join me along with Captain Belts for a special presentation. Admiral, we have a special plaque for you to keep safe until it can be displayed on CVN 80. On it is a piece of steel from CVN 65 that has been forged into a big E. There is an inscription that reads, "This steel from USS Enterprise, CVN 65, symbolizes 55 years of distinguished service to the United States of America. It also represents the next chapter in the life of Big E, as her steel will be used to build our nation's next USS Enterprise, CVN 80. May her legend always prevail in the pursuit of American liberty, justice, and freedom."
Thank you, Mr. Mulhern. I gratefully accept this plaque on behalf of the United States Navy and of all the men and women who have designed, built, and served on one of the eight Navy ships named Enterprise throughout our nation's history. This plaque will serve as a tribute to those ships and will be included in the ship's museum on the Navy's ninth Enterprise, CVN 80. Admiral Caldwell, fellow flag officers, Captain Belts, officers and crew of Enterprise, distinguished guests. As you know, Enterprise is a legacy. From the first schooners named Enterprise in the 1800s to 1934, when Newport News first laid the keel for the aircraft carrier CV-6, which would become the seventh U.S. Navy vessel to bear the name Enterprise. But the first to earn the nickname the Big E with 20 battle stars during World War II. To the Cold War age, where CVN 65 became the world's first nuclear-powered aircraft carrier and the first to serve 51 consecutive years. This plaque symbolizes the passing of a torch to CVN 80 and her future crews. Some of those who will serve on the future Enterprise haven't even been born yet, but upon reporting to duty, they will look at this very plaque and know that it represents all those that have come before them, and the legacy will live on. Just like I'm sure many of you who are here today feeling, I'm honored and humbled to be a part of history and this chapter as we turn the page. Thank you to everybody for helping me be a part of this next chapter. Now I have the honor of introducing our next speaker, Admiral James Caldwell. Admiral Caldwell is a submariner of the highest caliber. He served in both the Atlantic and Pacific fleets on both fast attack and ballistic missile submarines. He commanded USS Jacksonville, SSN 699, homeported in Norfolk, Virginia, and also led Submarine Development Squadron 12 in New London and Submarine Group 9 in Bangor, Washington. He has been assigned to numerous other Navy and Joint Commands and was commander of the U.S. Pacific Fleet Submarine Force in Hawaii, where I first met him. He became the Navy's 7th Director of Naval Nuclear Propulsion Program in August of 2015. Please welcome Admiral Caldwell.
Good morning, everybody. Fellow flag officers, honored guests, captain, crew of the Enterprise, I am absolutely honored to be here today. Especially for a submariner, I never thought I would be standing here on the hangar deck talking at the decommissioning ceremony for Enterprise. When I learned of this ceremony, I said, well, that sounds like a great idea. So I turned to Captain Belts and said, Captain, can I be included in that? And the captain, without hesitating, said, why, sure, Admiral, that's a great idea. So, Captain, thanks so much. I wanted to be here, folks, for the simple reason to say thank you to the fantastic team of sailors, Newport News shipbuilding personnel, who did this tremendous work of defueling Enterprise. This was a long, arduous, very demanding task, and for that, you have my thanks. I'm going to talk about that in a few minutes, but I would like to reflect on the history of Enterprise. It's been said before that this is a bittersweet day, and I agree. It's sad to see the last day of a ship that was really unmatched in her lifetime. So today is a good time to reflect on what Enterprise accomplished and what she meant to the United States. If you have any doubts as to what I think about Enterprise, all you would need do is visit my office, where behind my desk, and the first thing anyone sees when they walk into my office is that iconic photo of Nuclear Task Force One. Many of you have seen it. The Bainbridge, the Long Beach, the Enterprise, with sailors in formation famously spelling out E equals MC squared. And then in the corner, I have a smaller version of that picture with E equals MC squared 50, 50 for 50 years. When you think about it, it is really phenomenal. When Enterprise was launched, she was the biggest ship in the world. Her 8 reactors, which still inspire awe, and for a submariner thinking of 8 reactors, I have a hard time wrapping my head around that. That comprised the most powerful nuclear power plant on the face of the Earth. On initial sea trials, her escort, USS Laffey, DD-724, tried to keep up, but it was to no avail. After a full-speed run, Laffey messaged the Enterprise and said, you win the race, fuel gone, topside salted, crew wet, and engines tired. Enterprise pulled back into port here in Newport News with flying a broom from her island to signify a clean sweep on her sea trials. That was the first of many times that Enterprise proved her worth. During the Cuban Missile Crisis, she operated with USS Independence, another carrier. During the 40 days of operations, I'm told that Independence burned 5.5 million gallons of oil. Enterprise had gone further, faster, and burned none. Because Enterprise didn't need to refuel, she could carry 2 times more aviation and ordnance, or aviation fuel and ordnance than any other carrier. The lack of corrosive exhaust gases associated with a conventional plant simplified the maintenance and the aircraft operations on this ship. Her power plant allowed for increased shipboard electrical power, and over the life of the ship allowed us to install and modernize new radars, sonars, and missile systems. In short, nuclear power was a game changer. It allowed virtually unlimited endurance at high sustained speed and with that tactical flexibility and freedom of action that the Navy demanded. And our nation certainly put Enterprise to use. These capabilities were put to use in the Cuban Missile Crisis, in Vietnam, and in Afghanistan. Enterprise was part of and helped make and shape our nation's history for over 50 years. And this isn't my quote, but when it comes right down to it, this is true. I believe it was the Secretary of the Navy who said this. Enterprise was as relevant on her last deployment at 51 years old as she was on her first. And that, my friends, is very impressive. Now, none of this would have been possible without the true force of gravity and center of gravity behind it, and that's the Naval Nuclear Enterprise. And that's one thing I want to talk about today because it is really remarkable. This incredibly powerful combination of shipyard, Department of Energy labs, the Naval Reactors team, and very importantly, the sailors, the men and women who operated Enterprise. Together, this team envisioned Enterprise and brought her to life. The design work at the Bettis Lab and Naval Reactors started many years before the ship was built. And then the shipyard built and delivered her to tough standards, ahead of schedule. This team that I talked about kept Enterprise running as a central piece of our nation's Navy for 50 years. While the ship itself was the envy of the world and the hardware was the envy of other navies around the planet, the actual power behind it, the competitive advantage that consistently outpaces our competitors, was and is this core of engineers, builders, maintainers, designers, skilled laborers, and sailors that took Enterprise to every imaginable place around the world, that refueled her and maintained her and eventually defueled her. This team is what makes America's nuclear Navy unmatched in the world. Now, since inactivation, this team has been working to defuel the 8 reactors. This was far from business as usual. We took the most complicated reactors in the fleet. We used our legacy reactor servicing equipment combined with first-time use handling equipment. And we christened a new facility here in the yard to complete this job. To give you a sense of the complexity, there has been more than a decade of planning for the work of defueling Enterprise. That included writing procedures, preparing and testing the operating equipment, and it came down to really a daily grind that got us here today. So to all of you that labored and eventually finished this job, I say thank you. You have my deep personal admiration and thanks for doing the job professionally, safely, and to the exacting standards that the Naval Nuclear Propulsion Program demands and that our nation demands. And I think it's really remarkable, folks. If you haven't been involved in it, it may be hard to understand, but I'm here to tell you it's been quite a remarkable undertaking. As I close, I'd like to look forward. Admiral Anderson, who was the CNO during the Cuban Missile Crisis, famously said that the Navy has both a tradition and a future, and we look to both with pride and confidence in both directions. The same is true of Enterprise. We look back with pride, but we don't have to look very far to be confident in the future. The legacy of Big E will live on as we bring CVN-80 to life in this very yard. Compared to the Nimitz class, the new Enterprise will have 25% more reactor energy, nearly 3 times the electrical generation capacity, and the reactor department will be 50% of the size of the current Enterprise. And following CVN-65's example, the new Enterprise will run for 50 years. As with any other warship, no matter how great the design, no matter how revolutionary the concept, or how good the hardware, what will make Enterprise a great warship are the thousands who will sail in her and the team that will maintain her for sea. These are the people that are standing to my right and the people that are standing in the back. And for that, folks, I think they deserve a great round of applause. So think about the missions the new Enterprise might be called to perform. While it's impossible to predict, I can say these things with certainty. CVN-80 will carry the name Enterprise proudly because of what this team has accomplished in this shipyard. And future generations, just like those of us here today, whether builders, operators, or maintainers, will proudly boast that they are part of the legend and part of Enterprise. Thank you, and God bless all of those who made Enterprise the great ship that she was.
Thank you, Admiral Caldwell, for those remarks. Ladies and gentlemen, it's now my pleasure to introduce our presiding officer, Commander of Naval Air Force Atlantic, Rear Admiral Bruce Lindsay. Admiral Bruce Lindsay is a 1982 graduate of the Naval Academy and was designated a Naval Flight Officer in 1983. At sea and shore, Admiral Lindsay served at several commands, most notably as commanding officer of VS-29 embarked aboard USS Carl Vinson, CVN-70, USS Dubuque, LPD-8, and USS Carl Vinson, CVN-70. He served as commander carrier strike group 10, and most recently as commander carrier strike group 4. Admiral Lindsay assumed command of Naval Air Force Atlantic in July 2016. Ladies and gentlemen, Admiral Bruce Lindsay.
Good morning, USS Enterprise and Norfolk Naval, Newport News Shipyard. You know, you put two N's and an S together and that's what you get. But you all are the distinguished guest today, okay? And I want to make sure that is clear. And I met a couple of outstanding folks here from the ship, Enterprise. They're going to go to Bush and everything. We're going to try to arrange them first-class tickets on a NALO flight, all right, get them over there. And for the shipyard workers, I met some great shipyard workers right down here. Shirley, I think she said she started this project, and by golly, she's going to finish this project and everything. She's flanked with some other shipyard workers who have worked for over 60 years, and then we have a nuclear machinist mate from the original time of Enterprise. You all are the distinguished guest here today, and it's an honor to be here. So forget all those admirals up there. So again, Captain Belts, it is indeed an honor and a privilege to be here today to say goodbye to such a great warship, and a great warship she has been for 55 years, as you all know. Now, I thought rather than give a speech about USS Enterprise herself, I want to explain why we have nuclear carriers, why we have carriers that are needed today and well into the future, and hence why the name Enterprise will be on the third Ford class carrier here soon. And to answer those three whys, I wanted to tell you some personal sea stories. I'm a sailor just like the rest of you. I've got sea stories, and I want to tell you some sea stories about USS Enterprise from a young naval aviator's standpoint or viewpoint. Yes, that's correct. USS Enterprise was my first aircraft carrier. And you all know that a ship is just a hunk of steel, magnificently put together by the shipyard, okay? But it is when those sailors, okay, come aboard this ship for the first time and she comes alive, when she is manned by her first plank owner sailors, her sea stories become our sea stories, and her history is our history. And on a day like today, when USS Enterprise will take her last accolades, it is fitting that we share our sea stories such that the memories of this great warship and the lessons of why we built her and continue to build great warships such as Enterprise are never forgotten. So, let me take you back. Some of you weren't born, I know, but it was in October of 1984 when Enterprise was about a little over 20 years, I think, old, and I flew from San Diego, California, via Clark Air Base in the Philippines to Diego Garcia to Masira to catch the cod out to VS-21 embarked in USS Enterprise CVN-65 as she patrolled what we called Gonzo Station up there in the North Arabian Sea. because you see, in those days, we did not steam aircraft carriers into the Arabian Gulf. For the rest of our time on Gonzo Station, which included 3 beer days, I only got one, but there were 3, I am told, I flew one of the 10 S3s embarked on USS Enterprise's massive flight deck. So the first reason we built and continue to build nuclear carriers is time. Not only do they last a long time, as you see here today, 55 years, they can also stay on station for a very long time. And please understand, one cannot influence world events if you are not on station and stay on station. In other words, to be where it matters, when it matters. Now, Enterprise is a tough ship. And when I mean tough, I mean she could take damage and keep on going. And although no enemy ever put a weapon on her, we did inflict self-damage, similar to taking a torpedo hit in combat. It was during workups off of San Diego there in, I think it was 1985, in the vicinity of Bishop's Rock. I was flying on board the final battle problem to get on board the ship, and I noticed through my forward-looking infrared there that the Big E was listing to port. And pretty significantly, I said, wow, this is going to be a good landing. Come to find out, after that landing, she had already run over Bishop's Rock and just kept on going, all right? And after the crew had gone to GQ, like the good crew would do, and battled the incoming water, we just kept on flying. I am told that the engineering solution was a concrete blister, sort of like throwing sackcrete down there, and it just filled up, and then you kept on going. All right, we deployed on time in January 1986, and of course, Big E did vibrate at higher speeds for the rest of her life. Just a little shudder there, okay? But she still is the fastest carrier in the fleet. She could take a hit and stay in the fight. So the second reason we built and continue to build nuclear aircraft carriers is that they can take battle damage and continue to take the fight to the enemy. Nuclear carriers are tough, and no other country can match us in this respect. So then I was on my second deployment there. Enterprise took me to the South China Sea, the Indian Ocean, and into the Mediterranean Sea. And in all 3 seas, we dominated the surface, the air, and the undersurface domains. As we approached the South China Sea from the Eastern Pacific Ocean, we were able to project sustained combat air power up to 1,000 nautical miles from the carrier, because Enterprise was a nuclear carrier and carried a lot of jet fuel. All right? Roll with me, people. This is supposed to be a happy day here, okay? You don't have to laugh at me, but you know, come on, this is gonna be good. I'm telling you sea stories, all right. Okay, so when we entered the Indian Ocean there, the 10 S3 aircraft hammered a Soviet Union submarine. I can't tell you which one, okay? But we hammered that Soviet submarine with active sonobuoy so much, I am sure that those Soviet sailors have a loss of hearing to this day. We also ensured that Iranian ships, interesting, Iranian ships did not menace local shipping between Pakistan in the east and Oman in the west of the North Arabian Sea. All right, so then Muammar Gaddafi, if you remember him, he had some threats, and so we were ordered to enter the Mediterranean Sea via the Suez Canal, and there we debunked his line of death rhetoric by tracking his Foxtrot submarines and forcing them back into port and conducting mirror image strikes in the ocean to demonstrate our capability to render Libya's airfields inoperative. So the third reason that we built and we continue to build nuclear carriers is that they can carry lots of airplanes, lots of bombs, and because I like hunting submarines, lots of sonobuoys, all right? So that we can dominate the air, the surface, and the subsurface domains out to 1,000 nautical miles. Nuclear carriers bring capacity and capability. So after being so successful there with Muammar and Libya, we anchored in Toulon, France, and the French hospitality was great, the sailors were awesome, and it was the French Open, so what more could you wish for? It was awesome. But then somebody higher up decided that it's time to set sail, and not going through the Suez to go home, they sent us to the Straits of Gibraltar. And that's where I learned that Africa is a very, very big continent. So we went through the Straits of Gibraltar. It was Enterprise, Truxton, and Arkansas, all nuclear capable. All three nuclear ships sped at high speed around Africa without any resupply ship for food or fuel until we passed Diego Garcia, and then we headed to Perth, Australia, and anchored there. So the fourth reason we built and continue to build nuclear aircraft carriers is that they have sustained speed and maneuverability that no other ship in the Navy or in the world has today. And as Maverick said in the movie Top Gun, which was playing in Perth that year, had just come out, "I feel the need for speed, and you can only get that in a nuclear aircraft carrier." Well, after 8.5 months on deployment, we returned to Alameda to our families, and that highlights the fifth and final reason we built and continue to build nuclear aircraft carriers, is that they are big, and they strike fear in our enemies. But at the same time, they reassure our allies, our friends, and most of all, our families. So as I close today, I have been thinking about what I should say on such a momentous occasion. It hit me that I do not know what to collectively call the 346 sailors of USS Enterprise today, the crew of a warship on its last day in commission. We've all heard about the Navy term plank owner, and we have a plank owner over here with a hat that says so, okay? An individual who was a member of the crew when that crew was first commissioned, placed in commission. But we've never had a Navy term that I'm aware of that talks about the crew when the ship is placed out of commission. So you all should take great pride today in knowing that you are the last plank owners of USS Enterprise CVN 65. Now, first plank owners usually get a certificate, right? You got that nice certificate procured, issued to the crew members by the ship being commissioned. And they are not official Navy documents, but they're very colorful, very nice. Some ship's crews go ahead and make their own, and others purchase them from a commercial source. All good, but what do we give the last plank owners of USS Enterprise, CVN 65? Well, thankfully, Captain Belts solved that dilemma and that problem. He has given his crew, the last plank owners of USS Enterprise CVN 65, a piece of the ship. And I think that is fitting and right. And I am humbled that Captain Belts honored me and gave me a piece of the ship today. This is what I think all the crew members are getting. And I am very honored to be an honorary last plank owner of USS Enterprise CVN 65. So, as an honorary plank owner of USS Enterprise CVN 65, I charge you all with a solemn duty to never forget. Never forget this great warship, her great history, and the great Americans who sailed in her and built her and maintained her. And please, retell her sea stories in such a way that the new plank owners in CVN 80 will carry on the proud legacy and the warfighting spirit forged by all the previous warships and sailors who sailed in Enterprise. God bless you. God bless all that have sailed in USS Enterprise, maintained her, and built her. And God bless this great nation of ours. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Admiral Lindsay. Admiral Lindsay, Captain Belts, would you please join the Admiral at the podium for your award, please, sir? Enterprise, attention. Military personnel, attention to award. The President of the United States takes pleasure in presenting the Legion of Merit to Captain Todd A. Belts, United States Navy, for services set forth under the following citation. For exceptionally meritorious conduct in the performance of outstanding service as executive and commanding officer in USS Enterprise from March 2013 to March 2017. A visionary and inspirational leader, Captain Belts planned and executed the first ever inactivation and decommissioning of the oldest and most complex nuclear-powered aircraft carrier in the fleet. His innovative spirit and focused determination led to the completion of 40% of the defueling process in less than 9 months' time, while maintaining zero safety mishaps, setting the bar high for future CVN inactivations. During the ship inactivation process, he was intrinsically involved in the consolidation of 18 departments into 4 flexible departments with no loss in capabilities, which maintained medical readiness above the fleet standard at 96%, reduce manning from 2,500 to 500 personnel, and maintain advancement rates at or above Navy's average. Completed 6 certifications of the largest A-90 complex ever constructed, and safely conducted 104 defueling lifts in support of reactor plant inactivation. His guidance and leadership ensured Enterprise sailors maintained the highest state of readiness, and the ship was ready for delivery to the shipyard. Singularly impressive, his creativity, his judgment, and technical expertise galvanized Enterprise to achieve and sustain unprecedented levels of personnel and production excellence during his tenure. His personal involvement, exceptional communication skills, and commitment to excellence provided the crew with motivation and safety throughout the arduous inactivation and decommissioning process. By his dynamic direction, keen judgment, and loyal devotion to duty, Captain Belts reflected great credit upon himself and were keeping with the highest traditions of United States service. Signed, for the President, Bruce Lindsay, Rear Admiral, United States Navy, Commander, Naval Air Force Atlantic. Ladies and gentlemen, Captain Belts will now read his orders.
From Commander, Naval Personnel Command. Subject, official change of duty orders for Captain Todd A. Belts, United States Navy. Bureau of Naval Personnel, order number 3506. When directed by reporting senior, detached from duty as commanding officer, USS Enterprise, CVN 65, and report to Naval Leadership and Ethics Center for duty as assigned.
Military personnel, please be seated. Enterprise, parade, rest. Commanding officer, request mission to haul down the colors and secure the watch.
Executive officer, haul down the colors and secure the watch.
Aye, sir. Officer of the deck, haul down the colors.
Aye, aye, sir.
Haul down the colors.
Executive officer, colors have been hauled down.
Very well. Commanding officer, colors have been hauled down.
Very well.
Enterprise, attention. Officer deck, secure the watch.
Aye, sir. Secure the watch.
Enterprise, secure the watch.
Executive officer, the watch has been secured.
Very well.
This is the final watch, stood proudly and continuously with honor, courage, and commitment for 55 years on board this great warship, USS Enterprise, CVN-65. We are legend. Captain Belts will now read the order to decommission USS Enterprise and will ask to decommission the ship from Admiral Bruce Lindsay.
To Commander Naval Air Force Atlantic, from Chief of Naval Operations, Washington, D.C. Message Daytime Group 211636 Zulu, September 16. Decommission USS Enterprise CVN-65 due to end of service life, effective 3 February 2017. Custody is hereby transferred to Supervisor of Shipbuilding, Newport News, Virginia.
Executive Officer, strike the commissioning pennant.
Strike the commissioning pennant, aye, sir. Officer of the deck, strike the commissioning pennant.
Aye, aye, sir.
Strike the commissioning pennant.
Executive officer, commissioning pennant has been struck.
Very well. The distinctive mark of a naval warship in commission, other than the national ensign, is her commissioning pennant, which flies from her mast. In following with naval tradition and customs, Command Master Chief Huff will now present Captain Belts with the pennant. Ladies and gentlemen, that concludes the decommissioning ceremony of USS Enterprise. We ask that you join us in the reception area for light refreshments. Transportation to the parking area for invited guests will be available shortly at the end of the brow. Decommissioning crew, dismissed. Thank you.